There is a couple topics I'm super passionate about. Cancer's definitely set us on our journey, and visiting with the people with the answers is what I'm all about. And as far as it goes with humic and fulvic minerals, Caroline Allen is the expert. Let's visit with her. So good to finally be on a Zoom face-to-face with you. Definitely talked a lot in the past. Just for everybody watching, the thing that got me was I'd listened to a podcast that you had done with Dave Asprey, the bulletproof guy, the original biohacker, and brought your products in when Lander was diagnosed very, very early on. So he was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, and we did undergo conventional treatments as well as doing a lot of other things. So Beam Minerals, from a perspective of getting goodies in him and trying to get the bad stuff out, is what I was really passionate about with your products, and just been following along with you and brought your products into the market because they work, and just wanted, you know, your story. You got a great story, and you have all the knowledge that we can all learn from. And so I'm honored to be visiting with you and being able to share that.
Thank you. And how is Lander doing today?
Lander's doing great. So 2 weeks ago we had, another set of clear scans, and he's, 2 years out.
Fantastic. You know, there is an interesting story kind of related to this, that there was a man, his name was Dr. Frost, and he was tasked by NASA to figure out how to keep astronauts in space. And the problem is that when you put people out in space, they get a lot more radiation because they don't have the atmosphere to protect them. And they have, you know, the more radiation you get, the more possibility of cancer you have. And so he, after lots and lots of research, determined that the best way to keep those astronauts safe while they're in space was with humic and fulvic minerals.
Really?
So when their systems are highly mineralized, and particularly with these humic molecules, the humic molecules are constantly doing this cleanup and removal of heavy metals from the system. There's actually a whole thing called the Frost Report. I think you can look it up. And it's quite interesting and pretty out there, I'm telling you, pretty amazing also.
I will have to find that. Yeah, I'll get that and dive into that. The radiation's a big deal. It's been a massive concern for me with Lander, with all the scans, and he actually did have 16 radiation treatments. So that's always been in the back of my mind as something like just kind of stresses me out. Will you explain just kind of the overview of minerals and why we don't have them and why the deficiencies are so common now?
Yeah. You know, one of the things I like to help people get a handle on is if you think about your body, and if you took all of the water out of your body, you'd be a little pile of minerals. So if you look around your room, everything in the world, everything on earth is made of minerals. So I really want people to shift their thinking about minerals and how important they are. They are the fundamental, foundational building blocks of your body. So the other kind of reframe for people is we tend to think about illness or disease or chronic problems as a problem with a tissue or a bone or a system, you know, the cardiovascular system, the heart, or an organ, or an endocrine system, or, you know, enzymes or whatever. But when you think about your body, every single part of your body is made of cells. You are a cellular being, just like a plant. Well, you're obviously not exactly like a plant, but your gut sure works a lot like a plant. So when I started doing all this research about these minerals because of the effect they had on my health, I had so many ahas, because what I realized is that what drives the cells in your body, of which your entire body is made, is minerals and amino acids. So if your cells don't have a full spectrum of minerals, not just the few that we hear of that our doctors say we need to take or kind of is in the mainstream, but, you know, odd minerals like molybdenum or copper or phosphorus, things that you wouldn't go to the health food store and buy a pill and take because you only need a very small amount of it, but it's a very important part right. of your cells, of the engine of your cells. So that's the first, you know, reframe. Your entire body is made of cells and everything is driven by minerals. I sat on a panel recently, a longevity panel, and the moderator was asking all sorts of questions about, you know, longevity, and each person on the panel came from a different, maybe they had a particular product or they had a particular expertise, or, you know, one guy was a heart specialist, different things like that. And, you know, the interesting thing was every single one of them by the end of that panel said, and it's the minerals. If you are mineral deficient, you're going to have more problems. And my product or my brand or my particular focus is going to be challenged. So by the end, we just said, it's the minerals.
It's the minerals.
So if you,
Well, I'm a huge believer in supplements. And I have seen how magnesium has changed a lot of lives, like it, firsthand, like no questions asked. But what I am also seeing is that there's a lot of supplements, probably the majority of them, that our bodies can't even utilize. So we are taking them and we're getting a positive effect or no effect, but why is it that we are not able to use those supplements?
Yeah. So this is such a huge thing, and I'm personally on a mission to empower people, because people are spending a lot of money on supplementation that's not really having an effect in their body. So I'm going to give you a really quick synopsis of what happened with me, so, and why I'm so inspired about this. So I came out of a corporate career and I had flatlined adrenals. I had really bad inflammation in my gut. I had constant bloating and discomfort when I ate, and just bad elimination problems. I had inflammation in my mouth, really bad, that had been going on for many years, where I had really deep pockets. I had receding gums and bone loss in my teeth. The dentin in my teeth was becoming soft and punky. I had headaches almost every day. I had sinus infections recurring every few months that would last for 4 weeks, 6 weeks. And that was after being gluten-free. I had realized through my MD, actually, that I was badly gluten intolerant. I never had a celiac test, but definitely quite gluten intolerant. And I realized that had been going on since I was a child, because I had skin problems and all sorts of problems growing up. So I had systemic inflammation, and I started taking these plant-based liquid minerals, and I literally, over the space of 6 months, saw a resolution of the gut problems, the mouth problems, the headaches, the sinus problems, and my adrenals went up, like one third up on the chart from being completely flatlined. So this is why I did so much research. And in the process, I had such amazing ahas. And it has to do with this concept of bioavailability. So, you know, people who take supplements know a lot of times they say, oh, you have to take this one with this other thing, or you have to take it at a certain time of day, or you have to take it with or without food. And this is all about trying to make that supplement more bioavailable, this buzzword. But what I like to do is break it down for people, because when I really understood this, it completely changed the way I think about the food I eat, the supplementation that I do, and how I do it. So bioavailability has three stages. First is digestion. We all think we understand that, but I am going to talk about it a bit. The second is absorption. That means getting those nutrients that have been broken down into your bloodstream. That's called absorption. And the final stage is called assimilation. And assimilation is getting those nutrients, those minerals, those things into your cells. So out of the bloodstream and into the cells, okay? So all three of those stages have to be present for something to be bioavailable. There are some things that are utilized in the bloodstream, but most minerals and nutrients have to get into the cell where they become available to this thing called the mitochondria. Inside your cell, you have mitochondria. And this mitochondria is like the engine of your body. It produces all of the energy to run all of the processes, every single process in your body. And as it, just to kind of give you a scale on this, so in a single skin cell, there might be, 30 to 100 mitochondria in one single cell. Inside a heart cell, there might be 5 to 7,000 mitochondria. Inside a cell in your eye, 10 to 12,000 mitochondria in a single cell. So this gives you an idea of the concept. So you have in your body about 37 trillion cells. Can you imagine how many mitochondria you have that are constantly working to generate energy? So this is like, think about your body as an engine, and these mitochondria are the base units, and you have to keep feeding the base units so that they can do their work of generating energy.
The mitochondrial focus that's coming around is really, really interesting. And minerals are going to be those cofactors that allow them to do. They're almost like, I heard the analogy more of like a biochip than a power plant, right? So like they're the full factory that generate, their own power. The aspect of deficiencies of whatever that might be, and then the combined with the toxicity is where I have been so impressed with the humic and fulvic complexes, is because they address both of those issues.
Exactly. And we're going to get into how that is. I mean, the beautiful thing about the humic and fulvic is they're actually Mother Nature's solution. Mother Nature, developed over millennia these humic and fulvic complexes or molecules, which do replenishment of minerals in all cellular systems and also do natural detoxification of all cellular systems. So we'll get into how that works. But to go back to bioavailability, the thing about this that's so cool is that once you begin to understand how this works, it's going to change your mind. So first of all, understanding that all of these minerals and these nutrients, this, what you put in your mouth, it has to get digested, absorbed, and into your cells so it can be utilized by the mitochondria. So first stage, digestion. The interesting thing is, unless something gets digested all the way down to its ionic chemical components, it cannot be absorbed.
And so that would be basically its smallest form?
Yes. So when you take a powdered drink, let's say you're doing an electrolyte drink, and there's a large amount, 320 milligrams of magnesium in that drink. Now, first of all, because it's powder and because it's flavored, it has to be digested first. So it has to go through this incomplete process. And this is the amazing thing that people need to understand, is that only about 10 to 12% of that ever gets digested. And that's for a couple of reasons, partly because most of these mineral supplements are made from rocks, shells, bones, and how well does your body actually digest those things? The human digestive system is actually not very well versed in digesting those things. So again, that's part of the reason plant-based minerals are so effective, because your body is evolved over millennia to digest, to break down plant substances. So that's the first stage. So let's say this magnesium has digested down to its 10 to 12% of its digested down to its ionic components. It's ready for absorption. So let's talk about how that absorption process works. So it works inside your gut. There are these finger-like structures. They look kind of like fingers, and they're called villi. And lining those structures are something called epithelial cells. And lining each one of those cells are these receptor sites. And now here is the hugest aha that I had. Those receptor sites aren't just like general, you know, here, give me something and I'll take it in. No, they're actually specific to specific elements. So you've got a lot of magnesium receptors because we need, and potassium, and, you know, because we need a lot of those. But you also have a small amount of receptors for molybdenum and phosphorus and copper and zinc and iron. I mean, every element that your body needs. And there are a lot. There are many that we don't even know why we have receptors for them, because we don't know what they do, but we do know that we have receptors for them. Okay. So when I, what I want people to understand is how much of that act of that magnesium actually gets absorbed has to do with, number one, the health of the lining of your gut, right? How well, how are you doing with absorption? And that has to do with a lot of things about microbiome health, as we know. You know, the acidity or alkalinity of your gut, all sorts of different aspects about having a healthy microbiome. So the healthier your microbiome, the more absorption occurs, because you have more receptor sites that are healthy and available to receive something to bring it into your bloodstream. Okay, so a much smaller portion of that magnesium actually gets absorbed. Okay.
It's so, almost like a ball in a glove. There's only so many gloves to catch so many balls. And once it's full, it's full.
Exactly. And what happens to all of the rest of the magnesium that's in your system? Your body has to work to eliminate it. And that's the interesting thing. So this is the thing that completely changed my mind. You know, we tend to think of our body like a car. Need gas, put in gas. I need oil, put in oil. I need magnesium, put in magnesium. I need calcium, put in calcium, but et cetera. But the body does not work like a car at all. And in fact, your body is the absorption, assimilation process. It's so incredibly, miraculously intelligent that it knows what it needs and it goes for it when it wants it. So rather than creating, you know, and we talk about electrolyte balance, and I want to kind of bring people's focus to that, because minerals work in balanced pairs, and we don't really, we think, okay, I need magnesium, just put a whole bunch of magnesium in there. Let's say I'm having cramping and someone told me I need to take magnesium because I have cramping. But the fact is, you could have cramping because of an imbalance in the levels of your calcium and magnesium. So the CalMag balance, the ratio of calcium and magnesium, and there's a whole, that's a very involved conversation. We don't need to geek out too much about that, but it's actually really intriguing once you understand it, because it has to do with bone density as well. So there's all sorts of different pieces here. So what I want people to begin to think about is your gut is this, we talk about this word homeostasis. Homeostasis is the natural balance of nature. If you go out in a really healthy forest and you look at everything's just happy and green and looks really healthy and it's burgeoning and growing and blooming, and you know, you smell it, it smells so good. That's a healthy microbiome. So that's the way you want your gut to be. So when you have, I was trying to think of a good thing, but I don't know that a good idea that help people visualize this, but I think that forest is a good idea, you know, a good visualization. Like, you want your gut to be like a healthy forest. So when I think about out in nature, if you have a very large concentration of a particular mineral, you're either mining it or it's considered a toxic waste dump. So you don't actually want to create imbalance in your body by adding large amounts. 320 milligrams of magnesium is a lot to be throwing into your gut every day, and only 10 to 12% of it's getting absorbed, and the rest your body is having to work to get rid of. So mm-hmm. what we want to do is a complete paradigm shift. And rather than...
That's hard.
It's really hard, right? It's really hard. So, you know, rather than trying to hack our body by thinking of it like a car, and I'm just going to add a lot of stuff, spend hundreds of dollars to put lots of different minerals into my system, why not do it the way Mother Nature does and provide it via humic and fulvic molecules, which is the way all plants and animals across the earth are evolved to do mineral replenishment. So that kind of leads us into the whole thing about, well, what the heck are humic and fulvic?
So on that, what are they? What is a humic and fulvic complex? Because it's different than an acid, and I think a lot of people might, if they're familiar with this topic, are going to be more familiar with the acids. What is that difference, and what is a
humic and fulvic complex?
Well, first of all, let me just give you a quick overview. So imagine an entire rainforest back when the dinosaurs lived, and imagine that rainforest slowly over millennia decomposing. I actually have this great slide that I do when I do a presentation that shows a forest floor decomposing and has all these bugs and things, you know, working, and they're eating stuff, and, you know, they're pooping, and they're, you know, all these things are happening, you know, and it's slowly decomposing. So imagine an entire rainforest, and it's decomposed into this single strata of earth, of soil that's below the earth, 10 to 12 feet, sometimes 14, something around there. And it's completely black, and it's incredibly mineral rich. It's like all the mineral content of that entire rainforest brought down into this incredibly mineral rich substance. And that substance is called humate. And humate has two components. One is called humic, and the other is called fulvic. They're often referred to as humic acid and fulvic acid, but I'm going to separate it from that for right now. Let's just talk about humic and fulvic. So humic and fulvic are these two molecules, and they have some amazing properties. We're going to talk about fulvic first. So fulvic is a very, very small molecule, much smaller than a cell. It carries with it a full spectrum of all the minerals on earth, all the like 70 plus minerals on earth, okay, that exist on earth. And it's a very, very small molecule, much smaller than a cell. And it's called a flavonoid. So a flavonoid is a carrier. It's a very strong electrolyte, and things stick to it. So all the mineral content, the nutrition that you eat sticks to it, and it carries those through the cell wall, and it drops them off inside the cell. Now, how does it do that? It has an amazing, miraculous property. It can change its polarity. It's the only molecule on earth that they know of that can change its polarity from positive to negative or negative to positive. They've got a lot of theories and ideas about why or it does that, but when you start studying how it does it, you get into quantum mechanics, quantum physics, quantum singularity stuff. It's really, really complex. So it's really a miraculous thing. So it carries things into the cell, it changes its polarity, those things drop off, other things stick to it and carries those out and back and forth. Okay. So it also has some capacity. It does this changing of its polarity. And in the process, it interacts with the humic molecule. So the humic and fulvic occur everywhere together on Earth. And the humic molecule is very different. It's a large molecule, much larger than a cell. It hangs out in the bloodstream, and it's a very strong electrolyte as well. It does a few things. One, it interacts with the cell wall and with the proteins in the cell wall and opens more channels for things to go through. So it enhances nutrient uptake. Both humic and fulvic together greatly enhance the nutrient uptake, because not only do they open more openings in the cell wall, but the fulvic then can carry more nutrients in and toxins, bio waste, et cetera, out of your cells. If you're sitting in a room right now and you imagine you've got, you know, or you just look around, there's a couple doors or maybe one door and a couple windows. Now imagine mm-hmm. there's three doors and six windows. And now imagine
you get a lot more in and out.
Yeah. Now you imagine you have some really strong guys who can carry a whole bunch of things in and out. Now that's the fulvic, you know, and plus both of these molecules carry with them those 70 plus minerals. And the humic molecule also carries with it some amino acids, trace amino acids, and B vitamins, which are really extremely bioavailable, which makes them, because they're in the solution, because they're part of the humic and fulvic process, they are very available to the body. So when we talked about this, this bioavailability process, starting with digestion, then into absorption, now we have, if you have humic and fulvic in your system, you've got this incredible ability to get those nutrients, that magnesium that did finally get into your bloodstream, into your cells, where it can actually do its job.
That's a big deal. So us being in Arkansas and surrounded by cropland and farming, conventional farming, glyphosate is probably a much bigger issue than a lot of people realize, even though I think it's starting to come around that, hey, this is a bad problem. Again, the humic has got me very excited in a way, especially with some of the newer things that are coming out. Can you expand on that, the humic and glyphosate connection?
Mm-hmm. So the other aspect of humic that I didn't talk about is that it is an incredible detoxification agent, and it's a very gentle detoxification agent. Why is that? Because it chelates with heavy metals. It binds with free radicals in your system, so it's exponentially, like thousands of times more effective as an antioxidant than any superfood or other element that they know of, okay? It also binds with just bio waste and environmental toxins. And the final thing that the studies have just started coming out, they're out of China, and Japan, that the humic molecule has the ability to adsorb. This word, not absorb, but adsorb. And what it does is it actually creates a film around the glyphosate molecule, which inhibits its negative effects in your system. And then ultimately it binds with it and carries it out of your system. It also speeds the breakdown of the glyphosate molecule. So this has many implications, both for remediation of glyphosates in cropland, where people are trying to move away from using glyphosates in the production of food. It has incredible possibilities and potentials for the remediation of glyphosate in our systems. And let me give you a little, I don't know how much people know about glyphosates and how they affect you. But I think it might be, I could just give an overview. Would that be?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely. Because it's a big deal.
Yeah, it really is. And it's a systemic issue. It's not only an issue in Arkansas. I'm telling you, they found glyphosates at the North Pole. You know, glyphosates are in the air we breathe. They're in the water. And it's a full, there's a great book written by a woman named Stephanie Seneff, and it's, oh gosh, it's called Toxic Legacy. Fantastic, fantastic book. And she is really the quintessential researcher on this subject. So I'm gonna, she would talk very technically about this. I'm gonna try and break it down and put it in really simple language. But basically what happens when you ingest glyphosates, and let me be clear that it's not only just the glyphosate molecule, it's that glyphosates are mixed with something called adjuvants and surfactants. And these are substances that make the glyphosate more bioavailable to the plant. And it's actually the mix of the glyphosates with the adjuvants and surfactants that makes it problematic, much, much more problematic. It's also the fact that they're reapplying the glyphosates over and over and over again on the same fields. So you get this glyphosate molecule in your gut, and what it does is it attacks a certain set of enzymes in your gut called the CP450 family of enzymes. And the interesting thing about that is all of the gluten intolerance that we've been, you know, the rise in gluten intolerance, is it's the same set of enzymes. So
just a coincidence.
And they call this set of enzymes the first line of defense, because one of the things that these enzymes do is they support what we call tight junctions in the gut. And imagine your gut is lined with all these cells. Remember, we talked about all those cells, and those cells are literally like round, think about round things like balls pushing up against each other. And when they're tight, they're pushed up against each other. Nothing can get through. And when they're loose, there are spaces. And then environmental toxins, food particles that haven't been totally digested down to those ionic components, all those things get into your bloodstream, and those things create inflammation.
That your so essentially, body reacts. Leaky gut.
Exactly.
So.
Yes.
I think it was kind of a fringe term there for a while, but I think it's getting much more accepted for good reason. Right. So glyphosate's kind of one of the initializing aspects of that.
Yes. So when I went back, you know, after doing all the research into glyphosates, and I thought about all the positive health impacts that I'd had from taking Humic and Fulvic, I realized that not only were they affecting, you know, doing detoxification and doing better nutrient uptake, etc., they were also adsorbing the glyphosates out of my system and removing the glyphosates. So the leaky gut went away, you know, the inflammation stopped happening. I stopped having all this, allergic symptoms, et cetera. Yeah.
The detoxification has been a massive, massive focus for us. And one of the little stacks, and I wanted your opinion on this, that I try to do with Lander and ourselves, because like we're not done. Just because Lander has been cancer free for 2 years doesn't mean we're done, right? So I'm always trying to detox. And so we've got the infrared sauna, and what we will do is on an empty stomach, he'll take the charcoal and then the Humic. And so I was interested on your thoughts on that. My idea was that, you know, the infrared sauna helps release even more toxins, and now we've got the charcoal and the Humic to help attach it and get rid of it.
Absolutely. In fact, I was we were recently at the biohacking conference in Beverly Hills, and across from us was an infrared sauna company, and we had a long conversation about how much, if your system is fully loaded with the Humic minerals, how much more effective the detoxification in the infrared is going to be.
That's awesome. So, was it sunlighting?
Yeah, it was sunlighting, exactly.
So that's who we work with. I fully believe, you feel good about them?
Oh, I think they're the best. I really do.
Oh, that makes me feel even better. So that's combining the infrared with the beam minerals, the Humic, is a good companion, huh?
And one of the things I want, you know, people think a lot about detox, and the big things that are going to be happening in the world of health and wellness is, number one, mineral replenishment, people understanding mineral deficiency, understanding mineral replenishment, how it works, effective mineral replenishment. These are going to be the conversations you're going to start hearing. Literally every practitioner I talk to says to me, I need to figure out how to get minerals into my patients, every single one. So this is the vanguard. I call it the vanguard of health. The other one is detox, because we're dealing with systemic issues like glyphosates and other environmental toxin issues. So the whole concept of detox historically was you go through a detox protocol, you know, and a lot of times these are really involved processes with lots of pills and lots of products and you feel like crap during it and all the, you know, but the thing that I say that I think the thinking, people are beginning to change their thinking because they're going, okay, if you had intense toxicity, it might be really good to do a short-term protocol to do some chelation therapy or something, okay? But as soon as you finish that, you're now continuing to get those in your in the environment, those toxins are again continuing. So what we need to have as a foundation for constant detoxification is the humic molecule. What I actually say, you know, we need to get Mother Earth back into humans.
That's we're getting pretty far away. Well, Caroline, just thank you for your wisdom and taking the time to share. Hope this has been valuable. It has been to me. I appreciate all the questions that I ask you, and you always getting back with me. We're trying.
Thank you. And you know, you mentioned that you work with a lot of older women, and I'm an older woman. And what I want to say to those women is, if there is anything you can do to strengthen your hormone balance, your adrenals, your thyroid, this is the three-legged stool of an aging woman. And the more that you can keep that balance stool, that balance set between your adrenals, your thyroid, and your hormones balanced, the better off you are going to feel for longer. And minerals are the absolute foundational key for that. So if you looked at me, actually, I literally look younger today than I did before I started taking minerals.
You look great. I know. Obviously,
well, I don't know
what
about
you're
that.
Doing, what you're doing is working. And
we're going to keep spreading the message.
We are going to keep,
so much.
Keep doing it.
Well, right, Logan, I want to have more conversations with you about agriculture someday. And because I know you're in that world and we're moving into that world as well.
That's that foundation. That goes back to that foundation we were talking about. But yes, we are definitely going to follow up on that, and we'll visit soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.